Okay, I want to welcome you to another Bilkent Enerji Talks, and today we have the Pınar İpek, as well as our colleague, and she's going to talk about the Turkish interdependence with the energy suppliers challenges in energy.
Okay, thank you all for coming during your lunchtime and willing to listen this maybe after Monday's official ceremony about Turkish stream, kind of a daily topic. So my talk today aims to reassess Turkey's interdependence with energy suppliers and challenges in light of the role of energy security in Turkish foreign policy since 2004. Why 2004? Because that's the time when strategy paper concerning electricity market and privatization was issued. That's basically the major transformation of the electricity market especially. So there is a need to reassess Turkey's interdependence, a very common concept used in policy talks or in IR circles, given the conceptual definition of interdependence in IR liberal theory, that the ongoing turmoil in Syria, instability in Iraq, and especially after, as you may recall, Turkey's downing of Russian jet fighter at the Turkish border with Syria on November 24, 2015. So, despite the need for Turkey's diversification of energy suppliers and the country's high dependence on imported fossil resources, little change in the last decade. And the same group of countries preserved their large share in Turkey's total oil and gas imports. As you have seen in here, Turkey imports about overall 74% of its primary energy supply, and 60% of it is from oil and gas. So as of 2017, top three countries in oil imports are Iran, Iraq, and Russia, whereas the following ones are Saudi Arabia and Kuwait. And in gas, for the same year, the top three countries are Russia, Iran, and Azerbaijan. So, as you have seen by colors, this is not just for 1 year, a persistent share of Russia, a persistent share of Iran and Kazakhstan. So their shares are, despite the change in consumption, more or less Iran same. Actually, this last year was higher than any. And similar for Iraq, for oil imports, of course, after 2004, a little bit more, and other countries. The distribution of Turkey's oil and natural gas imports by countries between 2015 and 2017 demonstrate that, as I just mentioned, Russia has persistently the highest share in Turkey's natural gas imports, while it ranks the third in Turkey's oil imports. International Energy Agency defines energy security as uninterrupted availability of energy resources at an affordable price. In addition to accessibility, which I define as infrastructure availability as well, and affordability, the price, two other criteria I argue is important, namely the reliability of energy suppliers and sustainability in terms of environmentally friendly energy supply. Hence, pipeline-bound natural gas imports dominantly from Russia are crucial for affordability and reliability criteria in Turkey's energy security. So what I try to highlight here, reliability criteria is not questioned much, and that's what I'm questioning. In fact, the integration of TANAP, the pipeline, Trans-Anatolian pipeline, in June 2018, this June, which will provide additional 6 billion cubic meters of natural gas per year from Azerbaijan for Turkey's consumption, underlined the importance of accessibility and reliability in Turkey's energy security. Given because the high dominance of Russia and Iran in gas imports, Azerbaijan is a major stable resource for our natural gas demand. Accordingly, there is a considerable level of uncertainty for disruption in Turkey's electricity production, given the high share of gas supplies and pipeline-bounded gas imports. Although there has been some fluctuation in gas share in the total electricity consumption, for example, in 2004 it was about 41%, in 2008 almost 50%, in 2014 48%, and in 2017 35%. And the availability of hydro resources are very important, which depends on the season because it's a seasonal resource. So the fluctuation also relies on an environmentally vulnerable resource of hydro power. Within this framework, my question is, how can we assess Turkey's energy interdependence with energy suppliers to identify challenges, especially for the reliability criteria in energy security? So when we look at Turkey's asymmetric interdependence with Russia, that's my finding, right? An interdependence, but an asymmetric interdependence. Why? I'm going to explain soon. There are four dimensions of interdependence, namely its sources, benefits, relative costs, and symmetry. This is what I borrowed from the conceptual definition first time introduced by Cahon and Nine in 1977, but later, of course, updated the last one by his piece with David Welch in 2014. So, although the physical sources of energy security, such as availability of oil and gas reserves, infrastructure, finance for investment are important, the change in political elites and to an extent the public's perception of hostility of energy suppliers or other major powerful states involved in the geopolitics of energy-rich Eurasia and the Middle East also matter. Therefore, I argue that there are social choices as well as physical shortages affecting the energy mix of countries differently and their consequent foreign policy, especially in the long term. The economic benefits in the interdependence include also political aspects of interdependence, given the concern on distribution of relative gains, which is a very common argument in realism. So that brings not only cooperation, but also some political conflicts. For example, despite the benefits of energy trade for both parties, energy exports can also be used as a coercive instrument in international relations. In fact, the reliability of Russia, not only for Turkey, but also for the EU, because it's also a dominant gas supplier for EU, was questioned in various policy circles, especially after the 2009 Russian-Ukrainian gas crisis. For the first time in 40 years, there was a full cut of gas supplies through Ukraine from Russia in 2009. Turkey also faced a similar uncertainty after a different incident, the downing of Russian fighter jet. So while we see that there is serious efforts of diversification within EU to lessen gas supplies from Russia, Turkey, as we know, has just signed the Turkish stream, which I will talk why this Turkey's threat perception about Russia for energy security and reliability haven't changed. One of the responses to such skepticism about reliability of Russia in Turkey's energy security underlines the interdependence in terms of mutual economic benefits for both parties. Since Turkey has been the second largest export market for Russia after Germany. So mutual economic benefit in that interdependent relation. But what actually I would like to share is that when we look at overall trade balance of Turkey with its all major energy suppliers, these are for both oil and gas, right? Turkey has a large and consistent trade deficit with Russia. Well, you may say, well, it's the gas imports. But even when you look at our trade balance with Iran, it's relatively much smaller, which is oil. And even if you look at Iraq, we have a trade surplus. And this is...
There were some percentages as well. I didn't include them. Anyway, okay. So, fine.
All right. So, when we look at the other key measurement of interdependence, the relative costs, it can involve actually short-run sensitivity and long-term vulnerability. So Turkey's sensitivity in energy interdependence is considerably high because of the amount of oil and gas imports from Russia and Iran, high percentages, right? And further, natural gas in electricity generation cannot be substituted with other supplies in the short term in an affordable way. And there is currently insufficient gas storage capacity to support any gas disruptions in Turkey. Well, actually, Turkey has been moving slowly and lately about increasing its gas storage facilities. If there are questions, I can share the recent developments about that. So, for example, this well-known one, Tuz Gölü, Salt Lake, underground natural gas storage capacity, storage facility has not been finished yet, for example. It's still under construction. And in fact, Turkey initiated investment in so-called floating natural gas storage units. These are basically some large ships that sits next to an LNG terminal or to distribution of gas system to replace any disruption or shortages in natural gas imports in the aftermath of the relatively short-lived crisis with Russia after the downing of the Russian jet. This was the quick response given the increasing uncertainty about natural gas imports. So the first floating storage and regasification unit was built in Alia, Izmir by a private company, and the second one by BOTAŞ in Dörtyol, Hatay. But if you look at their capacities, it says, for example, 20 million cubic centimeters a day, right? And a similar for Dörtyol Hatay, about 21 million cubic meters per day. But according to the latest statistics on natural gas sector report by EPDK, Ministry of Energy, monthly total consumption of natural gas per month, not but per daily, maximum can be about 5.5 billion cubic centimeters and minimum 3 billion cubic centimeters. So if you simply multiply 20 million cubic centimeters with 30, right, it's still these floating gas storage units are not sufficient. And there is a conditionality even here because it has to be in full capacity. So once you consume it, I don't know how long it will take to refill the floating gas storage unit as well. Vulnerability, right, the other measurement for relative costs of interdependence, especially in the long term, refers to actually relative costs of changing the structure of a system of interdependence. In other words, the cost of adjustment for energy importing countries relies on their capability to decrease the share of imported fossil fuels in energy mix and to change their economic structure according to energy intensive sectors. Thus, managing a country's vulnerability in interdependence with energy suppliers in the long term depends also on different stakeholders in the energy market, such as private sector actors, consumers, energy firms, and large industrial firms, and their social choices on consumption and or production can drive the price even higher, particularly if there are no substitutes available. Therefore, Turkey's vulnerability in the relative costs of interdependence with energy suppliers underscores the importance of diversification of sources of energy supplies and technology for a long-term structural change in Turkey's energy mix. Finally, the last concept to understand the interdependence is the symmetry of interdependence, which I defined for Russia asymmetric. So it shows whether one of the parties is less dependent than the other. A major assumption indeed in assessing the symmetry of interdependence is that both parties strategically calculate and pursue interdependent relationship as a valuable for both of them. However, asymmetric interdependence can change according to different issue areas, and policymakers try to link or delink issues in interdependence. Thus, Turkey's asymmetric interdependence in energy security is evident for several reasons according to sources, benefits, and costs of interdependence. So, to sum up, Turkey apparently lacks sufficient energy resources for its energy consumption, has limited financial sources for investment in infrastructure or alternative energy resources depending on the type and technology. The benefits of interdependence with Russia and Iran blur the distinction between benefits for domestic energy market and foreign policy, which I will explain further in a minute. Because political benefits in interdependence also matter. For example, despite some disputes in bilateral relations among Russia, Iran, and Turkey, political benefits in interdependence between Turkey and its energy suppliers can be weighted more, for example, for the ongoing Syrian conflict. In other words, policymakers might link or delink foreign policy issues, political issues, to interdependence with energy suppliers. The costs of interdependence with energy suppliers are considerably high, given, as I said, Turkey's high sensitivity in the short term and vulnerability in the long term. The political benefits for all parties in other issue areas linked to energy interdependence, such as I said, the Syrian peace process, let's hopefully call it that way, the tension about the U.S. support for the PYD, Kurdish forces in the region. So Turkey's vulnerability influences cooperation and or conflict in energy security, given the uncertainty in changing geopolitics of the Middle East. Unless Turkey accomplishes a better diversification of sources of energy supplies and use of technology, especially for renewables in electricity production, to ensure long-term structural change in Turkey's energy mix. In short, these analysis of Turkey's interdependence with energy suppliers, especially an asymmetric one with Russia in natural gas imports, brings out an endogenous, brings out an endogenous process of explaining Turkey's energy security, driven both by material interests and what I argue as ideational forces observed in political elites' practices. So Turkey's new energy deals with Russia since 2010 are illustrative cases to examine Turkey's persisting asymmetric interdependence with Russia. I argue that Turkey's asymmetric interdependence with Russia cannot be fully explained by materially driven interests or strategic rebalancing acts in light of the US involvement and Russia's military presence in Syria. Rather, Turkey's seemingly trembling relationship with Russia and its persistent asymmetric interdependence in energy security are driven by both trade-offs and a cognitive bias embedded in the worldview of political elite and their self-conception of Turkey's national identity. So, to look at it quickly, there were a series of energy deals between Russia and Turkey, despite their ongoing disagreement over the Syrian crisis. In May 2010, there was the intergovernmental agreement for Akkuyu Nuclear Santral. In December 2011, Turkey signed, at that time, to be known as South Stream gas pipeline, right? It wasn't Turkish Stream at that time. In the following years, actually, there was criticism about Gazprom's bilateral energy deal with Bulgaria, breaching the EU's competition rules. So actually, the EU Commission antitrust investigation opened in September 2012 against Gazprom, implicitly influenced Russia's decision to convert South Stream to Turkish Stream. So in December 2014, as we know, a memorandum of understanding was signed between Russia and Turkey to build the so-called Turkish Stream gas pipeline. So recently Putin announced that actually Erdogan gave the name for it, but the initiative was totally in the control and in the decision of Putin, which Turkey agreed. However, as I said, Turkey's downing of a Russian fighter at the Turkish border with Syria in November 2015 has presented a serious challenge for both Turkish foreign policy and Turkey's energy security. In the following events, there were harsh sanctions introduced to Turkey, such as restrictions on trade, but there were no disruptions in Russian gas exports to Turkey. Negotiations between Turkey and Russia on the Turkish Stream pipeline project at that time suspended, right? Further, the natural gas price discount at that time coming from the West route through Ukraine for private companies, because that's the only pipeline privatized for natural gas exports. The negotiations for price discount for private companies was also canceled. So the crisis between Russia and Turkey ended when President Erdogan sent a letter to President Putin in June 2016. In the letter, Mr. Erdogan called Russia as a friend and a strategic partner. The Russian-Turkish relations further improved after the coup attempt against the Turkish government in July 2016. In fact, the final intergovernmental agreement on Turkish Stream was signed in October 2016. In addition to other agreements that aim to increase the construction pace of the Akkuyu nuclear power plant. And as we know, on Monday, November 19, the official ceremony for the completion of the C section of the Turkish pipeline occurred. So both the TANAP and Turkish Stream could be questioned not only because they are rival projects to transport natural gas to European energy markets, right? But they also undermine Turkey's long aspiration and efforts to become an energy hub. Very quickly, if you consider yourself as an energy hub, that means you have a market, a spot market for gas that you could sell to other markets. But there was apparently a disadvantage of both TANAP, that comes from Azerbaijan, right? And the Turkish Stream, because there is no permission for resale of gas. So basically, we just allow our territory for transit. So we become a transit country, not an energy hub. In light of major developments in the geopolitics of the Middle East, such as I mentioned, the sanctions on Iran, the recent one, the need to bring stability in Syria and ongoing instability in Iraq, the recent events in Basra, the need for diversification of natural gas suppliers and uncertainty about any disruption in electricity production and pipeline-bounded gas, which has the highest share in Turkey's electricity production, have been highlighted more than ever. Within this context, right? So what is the context? We have a persistent asymmetry and nothing changed, right? And there is a rising uncertainty. The question of how political elites pursue the costs and benefits of trade-off or interdependence cannot be answered sufficiently by a rational explanation. And I argue that an endogenous process of interdependence with energy suppliers is not limited to only trade-offs. Rather, trade-offs also include material interest in the domestic energy market. In other words, Turkey's the benefits of Turkey's interdependence with energy suppliers in energy security blur the distinction between benefits for domestic energy market and Turkish foreign policy. So very quickly, I think, can I talk, hocam, 5 more minutes? Yeah. What I mean by a shared material interest in domestic energy market. Turkey's growing energy demand, given our past, especially in the past decade, relatively higher economic growth rates, right? And our integration into regional markets, our increasing exports, not to EU, but new markets like Africa and some countries in Middle East, and our fiscal problems back in the mid-1990s, and the accession process to the EU at that time influenced liberalization of Turkey's energy market with the electricity market law of 2001. So Turkey's energy interdependence cannot be fully explained without these particular historical material conditions that mutually constituted the political elite's practices and material interests in Turkey's energy mix. JDP, Justice and Development Party government's willingness to integrate with global capitalism, which was a drastic change for the tradition of political Islam in Turkey, had prominent implications for the domestic energy sector. The privatization of power plants and electricity distribution companies and the new licenses for electricity generation constitute a particular alliance between the government and the newly emerging business. So when we look at actually Turkey's recently new and fastly growing large holding companies, they all have operations in energy market, whether in distribution or production. So Turkey's energy sector has been one of the fastest growing in the world energy market after China. Between 2008 and 2015, the energy sector attracted foreign direct investment in the amount of $50 billion. The abundant liquidity available to the emerging markets under the conditions of the global economy in the 2000s increased the role of private sector and its investment in transmission system, distribution networks, electricity and gas, and hydropower system projects. Indeed, today, private sector's electricity generation capacity is bigger than state's capacity. Generation capacity, not production necessarily. However, the executive branch political interventions have shaped the domestic energy market under this so-called neoliberalization process and the developmentalist tradition of the Turkish state. And indeed, Mesut is with us. He is my master's student. He conducted some interviews with electricity production companies in Turkey, not the auto producers, which means they produce for their own industrial production, but to sell. So a lot of them actually, almost all of them actually, exclusively complained about state intervention in the market. And actually the TEAŞ, the state electricity production companies, distorting the price mechanism. And indeed, one of the new foreign companies for gas, electricity production from gas, just left the country. They actually disassembled their facility and moved it to somewhere else. I mean, they disassembled the whole production facility, not just investing the, disinvesting their financial investment. So my conclusion is that in the lack of a better diversification of sources of energy supplies and higher share of renewables in electricity production to ensure long-term structural change in Turkey's energy mix, the foreign policy issues linked to interdependence with energy suppliers have increased uncertainty in Turkey's energy. In fact, Russia's military presence in Syria implicitly can sustain the asymmetric interdependence in its favor, since Turkey's short-term sensitivity in energy interdependence is high. Given, as I said, the high share of oil and gas imports from Russia and further high share of gas in electricity production. So I will not talk a lot about the part of cognitive bias in political elite practices in sustaining this asymmetric interdependence, but I just wanted to show you the recent comparison of the discourse used by the political elite during the ceremony by Mr. President Erdogan and Mr. President Putin. So Erdogan repeatedly considered Russia as a friend and even considered solidarity with Putin, his leadership, right, and as an individual leader, and the Russian people. Whereas the Russian Putin, right, the Russian party, has said that such an important project would not be realized unless parties had confidence. So leader to leader, rather than institutionalized relationship. And indeed, he praised Erdogan's role. Political will and courage of President Erdogan and Turkish parliament for immediate permission without discussion, no public policy discussion, right, for Turkish stream. And indeed, he said, Turkish stream and Akkuyu nuclear project will be symbols of the development of relations between Turkey and Russia. And at the end, he added, actually both parties added, given asymmetric interdependence, right, that his country, so Russia, wants to reach a 100 billion bilateral trade volume with Turkey. But this is the trade volume. So we don't know if this is going to be a surplus or a continuing deficit. So to conclude, what is important next for policymakers in Turkey, especially in energy sector and to an extent for Ministry of Foreign Affairs, is are contracts to be renewed with Iran in 2021 and the contract for Blue Stream. Right, so I don't know with the Turkish stream if there was any talks about Blue Stream as well, right? So in the next 2 to 3 years, we have to renegotiate talks for one of our major pipeline-bounded gas imports, Iran and Russia. Right? So that's why I argue that this uncertainty linked to interdependence for energy security in foreign policy has to be considered. To conclude, this is actually also an image that will tell us not just the trade-offs, rational decisions, but also the cognitive bias. I took this picture when I was in Brussels, in right, Brussels. You know these corridors where you pass from the main airport building to the plane, you know, those tunnels. So it's not quite easy to read. So I repeated it at the top. So this is the commercial of Statoil, one of the major gas companies of Norway. And after Russia, the second largest supplier of gas imports to Europe. So indeed, in their commercial, they say reliable energy with European gas. Right? So that is a non-Russian gas, right? It's a European gas. So there is a cognitive message there for the public or for the market. Thank you for your attention. If you have any questions or comments, please.
I have one comment and one question.
Sure.
The comment is that about the security of supply of natural gas from Azerbaijan. When you look at the map, there is a point that the pipeline passes through the Armenia so closely.
Right.
And this is the very same point that usually that there is a conflict between the Armenian soldiers and the Azeri soldiers. And so this is the area. If they can be provoked by the Russians, it could be a threat to the security of the pipelines as well. So that is one point. The second one is that we have a share as the TPA and the Shahdeniz too.
Yes.
And I don't know the share, but it's, I think it's around 16%. And I also know that the Russians explore various natural resources with India. It is on territory also. So, so do we have an option, or do we have an incentive, or do we have intention to explore this possibility that we will explore the area for the carbon-based energy sources in Russia? Because it may decrease our dependence a little bit.
So we will explore carbon-based energy sources where
in Russia, because India do that.
I didn't read or hear anything about that. So maybe after this Turkish stream, if you want to increase our trade volume to 100 billion, maybe there is an idea. Or you may introduce Hocam that idea. But I didn't read or hear such thing. But what I know is Russia is not very friendly for foreign direct investment. Indeed, in the early 90s, some major MNCs, Western MNCs, energy MNCs that were operating in Russia withdrew, disinvested. The only one that are dominantly remaining is Sakhalin Island, Shell, because it requires a different technology. So they are dependent for the Western MNCs technology in there. But for any onshore oil or gas exploration or production, it's mostly Russian companies. And Eni is not involved in production, it's involved in the pipeline distribution.
As far as I remember, the US started sanctions on the early 2010s, and then there was projects with Total, Shell, etc. On Russia for exploring oil and gas. But they were actually changing their mind to increase the foreign direct investment because they don't have much to invest themselves that much. I think it can be an option, maybe.
Indeed, some energy experts specifically studying on Gazprom, like one of the well-known ones is Tain Gustafsson. He is one of the leading experts on Russian domestic energy market, energy political or policy people, key position people. He keeps tracks of them, and he has books on Russian oil industry, Gazprom especially. So actually he had been making this argument that Gazprom eventually would have to open up the domestic market to foreign investment because of the problems within its structure. And indeed, some again reports say Russia or Putin, sorry, have been considering the problems of Gazprom and try to create a domestic competition by supporting, I can't remember the name of the other company, but the other oil company to create some competition for Gazprom's efficient investment. Yes.
Another question related to what's going on in Eastern Mediterranean. I mean, in recent months we have heard a lot of conferences being held, and if I'm not mistaken, Turkey has never been a party to that. Southern Cyprus coming together with, first of all, it was with Greece, if I'm not mistaken, and then they have added Israel and Egypt to that equation. And if I'm again not mistaken, they have even reached that agreement that when they are finished with drilling in East Mediterranean, they're going to transfer the entire oil and gas refinery to Europe, to first Greece and then Italy. I mean, Turkey could easily be a portion of that. Turkey is isolated, and where I'm puzzled is that Turkey is not reacting any yet against that. Why are we not a part of this discussion? Why are we not included? I don't get it. So.
Yes, actually Turkey recently reacted to it, so it's not on the headlines because, you know, Turkish political agenda is full of other issues, so, and we have a very quickly changing agenda and headlines as well. At the diplomatic level, Ministry of Foreign Affairs recently warned ExxonMobil, the American MNC actually, that will drill this month in the number 10 zone of offshore gas field offshore southern Cyprus. But the major problem that Turkey has been opposing, especially at the UN level, is what, as you hocam also said, executive economic exclusive zones that was declared unilaterally by southern Cyprus. And that is not acceptable for Turkey's position, because Greece and Southern Cyprus justify exclusive economic exclusive zones, EEZs, based on the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, UNCLOS, in short, UNCLOS. However, Turkey does not sign that agreement. That agreement was signed in 1982. And Turkey knowingly didn't sign the agreement and gave all its diplomatic notes, considerations at that time at the UN, because of the semi-enclosed Sea of East Mediterranean, and of course at that time, more importantly, agency. Because according to the UNCLOS, what important is how to, based on sovereignty principles, how to share undersea sources and navigation according to national waters for maritime. But UNCLOS defines the continental shelf, that means the extension of the continent under the sea, and limits it by 200 nautic miles. So you cannot delimitate agency nor East Mediterranean by 200 miles, because in Asia we have many of these little islands, and in Mediterranean, of course, Cyprus. We did delimitate Black Sea. How? All the littoral states, meaning Russia, Ukraine, Moldova, Bulgaria, Romania, came together, right, and made an agreement based on the principle of a median line. And that's what was Turkey's argument and position. So Turkey diplomatically offers, we have to do the same for the East Mediterranean. But actually, since the rejection of Annan Plan in the Cyprus dispute, Cyprus used this as a tool, energy resources as a tool for the conflict resolution, and they tried to attract the involvement of European energy companies like Eni, Total, that have been drilling there, and lately ExxonMobil. So if their claim is going to be agreed, which never, I think, for Turkey. Why? Because they claim that this little island offshore Kaş, if you ever been there, there is a little island there, even if you are a good swimmer, you could swim there, maze, right? Would make Turkey's continental shelf an economic exclusive zone very limited, so we would be basically left over somewhere at this corner. So we will lose our free navigation. All these waters would be Greek or Southern Cyprus waters. And there are actually examples of between Norway and UK, again, some oil-related resources. And as far as I remember, because again about an island between Alaska, US, and Canada. So they didn't apply the principle of UNCLOS for those economic exclusive zones. And we can actually apply those principles adapted to the conditions of these semi-enclosed seas, and that's what Turkey has been actually offering. But as you mentioned, Hocam, Southern Cyprus already made an agreement with Israel first, and Greece first, of course, Israel, Egypt. Egypt later cancelled actually that agreement. It was, so officially they don't have. And there is no agreement between Southern Cyprus and Lebanon or Israel and Lebanon. And if we talk about these offshore gas fields, we have to consider the Palestine people and Northern Cyprus as well. So unilateral deals just by Southern Cyprus exclude automatically the Palestinian or the Northern Cyprus people, no matter what, where the exclusive economic zones are. So this region is heavily disputed. We don't know how much feasible gas reserves there. There are only two fields that have proven reserves yet. And what we know so far, based on the drilling, only Southern Cyprus gas reserves are not sufficient for commercially developing and transferring that gas resources. But Egypt's Zohr field that has proven reserves and some potential reserves, and this new Nur field, which is again how much of the reserves are heavily disputed. It's again a very common actually bargaining process between the energy companies and the home governments. Home governments always like to exaggerate the reserve amount to increase their bargaining in the negotiation, to increase their royalty fees, right? That happened, for example, similarly in Caspian Sea resources or Central Asian oil and gas resources in Kazakhstan, Azerbaijan. Whereas energy companies would also always like to keep the reserves minimum, because if they agree that there is a lot of reserves, they don't want to pay high royalty fees for their operation there. So, but nowadays, of course, there are small companies that the governments can subcontract for drilling, for technological use of resources to support their own assessment of the reserves. So Turkey has been recently doing that, actually, the Fatih exploration ship, and it already created some disputes between the Greek military and the Turkish one. So it's, in short, to conclude, this is an international law dispute, and what Cyprus has been doing is not supported even by UNCLOS, because UNCLOS, United Nations Convention on Law of the Sea, gives a definition of the semi-enclosed sea, and given that definition, actually, it underlines that the economic exclusive zones should be delimited, should be decided among the all littoral states based on equity and sovereignty. Right, and what Southern Cyprus has been doing is not based on equity of, and they don't include all littoral states; they exclude Turkey.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Have a good day.